In the name of Allah, our creator, the creator of the universe and of everything that's in it, I greet you all, dear viewers, in our Islamic way. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May Allah's peace, blessings and mercy be with you all. We continue with our discussion on scientific notions in the glorious Quran, emphasizing the fact that this noble book is basically a book of guidance from our creator to man. We can come up with a criterion that can be used for discriminating between a true religion and a false one. And this criterion is the authenticity of the revelation that was sent down with the religion. If the revelation is intact, in exactly the same language of revelation, without the slightest human infiltration, without the slightest human introduction, the religion is correct. If the revelation has been lost or has been committed to a language other than the language of revelation, has been tampered by man, then the religion cannot be correct, even if it still contains some remnants of the initial truth. If we apply this criterion to all the isms of the time, we can see clearly that the only form of divine guidance to man that has been kept intact in exactly the same language of revelation, the Arabic language, preserved by the will of the Creator, word to word and letter to letter, is the glorious Quran and the traditions of Muhammad, peace be upon him. Being the last messenger from God to man, Allah has taken the responsibility to preserve his message in its entirety in the same language of revelation. And this preservation of the glorious Quran and of the traditions of Muhammad, peace be upon him, in exactly the same language of revelation, the Arabic language, is one of the many testimonies that can prove to every sane person that this is the only form of divine guidance that is accepted by Allah, by our Creator, from any human being. Any other belief will not be accepted because it's not authentic, it does not carry the divine word in its divine purity. And we mentioned that this divine guidance contains more than 1,000 cosmic verses. And these cosmic verses were not revealed to man to be pieces of scientific information per se. They all come in the context of testifying to the might, knowledge, and wisdom of the Creator, to testify to the fact that who has created this vast, immense, orderly universe with everything that's in it is capable of annihilating it and resurrecting everything again. And the area of resurrection has been highly denied and highly debated by unbelievers, by agnostics, because they were never taught the proper concept of divinity. The basic foundation of the divine guidance to man is that we have to honor our Creator, exalt our Creator above all his creation. He has to be above space and time, above matter and energy. Nothing in his creation is like him. And the devil has always been infiltrating into human ideas to simulate to them a form of divine being that is amidst the creation of the Creator. The basic foundation of Islam is to exalt the Creator above all his creation, above space and time, above matter and energy, above all human beings, above all animals and plants. This divine being, the supreme master of the universe, cannot be embodied, must not be embodied in the form of a statue, in the form of an animal, in the form of a plant. We have to exalt him above all his creation. One of the basic pillars of Islam is Hajj, pilgrimage. And usually we do not question the acts of worship. Acts of worship, by definition, are divine instructions that have to be obeyed to the letter. And if Allah has made pilgrimage an Islamic obligation on every adult, sane, capable Muslim, man or woman, we cannot ask why did Allah has made this obligation. We have to listen and obey. But understanding the wisdom behind this divine instruction can make every Muslim, man or woman, perform this action in a more precise manner and can enjoy doing it better and can gain the reward from doing it much more than doing it without understanding. So one can ask, why did Allah make Hajj, pilgrimage, an Islamic obligation? Through the glorious Quran and the traditions of Muhammad, peace be upon him, we understand that Mecca was the oldest piece of landmass created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is quoted to have said, كانت الكعبة خشعة على الماء فدحيت منها الأرض. The Kaaba was a prominence above water, and from that prominence, all the landmass was created through volcanic activity. And that's exactly what modern earth sciences have proved, that all the continental masses we are living on today were actually created from a single volcanic island amidst an inundating ocean. We also understand that the Kaaba was not built by man. It was built by angels at the moment of creation of this universe and was built in advance of the creation of man by several hundreds of billions of years. And that's why the Quran reads, بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم, إن أول بيت وضع للناس للذي ببكة مباركا وهدى للعالمين. The very first house established for human beings is actually the one in Mecca. And Mecca can be pronounced with an M, Mecca, or with a B, Mecca. And both names are used in the Islamic tradition. The very first house established for all human beings is the one in Mecca, full of blessings and many physical signs to express its holiness and its sacred nature. إن أول بيت وضع للناس للذي ببكة مباركا وهدى للعالمين. And in it there is guidance to all beings. We understand from this verse that the Kaaba was not built by man. It was built by the angels in preparation for the creation of Adam and Eve. May Allah be pleased with them both. And we understand this from a saying, أول من طاف بالبيت الملائكة. The very first creation that circumambulated the Kaaba were the angels. And as we mentioned in the previous episode, the farthest mosque was also built by the angels in the very first period of the creation of that universe, in the very first years of the creation of that universe, long before the creation of any human being. Because Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is quoted to have been asked, what was the very first place in which Allah was worshipped on the surface of that planet? He said, Al-Kaaba. And then the man who asked said, what's after? He said, the farthest mosque, Masjid Al-Aqsa. The period between the construction of both, he said, 40 years. And 40 years in 5 billion years, the age of the oldest rock on earth, is absolutely nothing. So we understand that the very first piece of continental mass that was created on the surface of our planet amidst an inundating ocean was the land of the Kaaba and of the farthest mosque. Because of this, we find that Mecca is at the center of the land masses. If we draw a circle circumambulating the Kaaba, the circle will encompass every single land mass on the surface of our own planet. And this has been both physically and materially proved, the centrality of the Kaaba with the respect of the land masses. So this must be a very important position. Inasmuch as Allah, in His glory, has exalted certain prophets above others, and certain measures above others, and certain human beings above others, He has exalted certain places above others and certain times above others. Allah in His glory has exalted the site of Mecca above all places on the surface of that planet. And He has exalted the very first 10 days of the Hijjah above all the times of our existence. So Allah in His glory wants to give every Muslim, man or woman, adult, sane, capable of performing pilgrimage, this advantage to be present in the holiest piece of land during the holiest days of the year so that he can get the blessings multiplied several folds. And we will break now, coming inshallah, continue with this issue in a few moments. Welcome back to continue our discussion about why Allah, all glory be to Him, has made pilgrimage, Hajj, an Islamic obligation on every adult, sane, Muslim man or woman, if he can afford the journey to Mecca, even for once in his life or her lifetime. We said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all glory be to Him, has made the site of Mecca the most blessed piece of land on the surface of our planet, if not in the totality of the universe. And He has also, in His eternal knowledge, has made the very first 10 days of the Hijjah, the month of the Hijjah, the most blessed time of the year. So Allah has made pilgrimage an Islamic obligation on every sane, adult, free, capable Muslim man or woman, for at least once in his or her lifetime, to bring every Muslim to the most holy place on the surface of the planet during the most holy 10 days of the year, so that his good deeds can be multiplied many folds. And this actually is a renovation of the Muslim's life. It reminds Muslim by the fact that death is a reality of our time. Yani leaving this world is one of the greatest realities of our existence. And the fact that one has to depart life and get ready for the afterlife is symbolized by performing Hajj. And really having the miqat is a sign for leaving this world, going to the world to come. Dressing in al-ihram is symbolizing the piece of cloth in which a dead body is shrouded, is covered, and circumambulating the Kaaba is conforming to the movement in that universe. Every single creation in that universe is moving in that direction, and this conformity can bring a lot of blessings to the human being. And the rest of the acts of Hajj actually are symbolizing resurrection after death, gathering for the Day of Judgment, standing in the plain of Arafat is symbolizing exactly the stand on the Day of Judgment, waiting for the judgment of every one of us, and then the movement to eternity in life to come, either in paradise forever or in hell forever. And going back to life is a process of purification of every Muslim man and woman who has performed this pilgrimage very precisely in the way recommended by Allah and by His Messenger, peace be upon him. So the verse reads, أَوَلَ بَيْتٍ وُضْعَ لِلنَّاسِ لَلَّذِي بِبَكَّةَ مُبَارَكًا وَهُدًى لِلْعَالَمِينَ. The very first house established for all human beings is the one in Bekka, a blessed place and a guidance to all human beings. And the Quran continues, فِيهِ آيَاتٌ بَيِّنَاتٌ مَقَامُ إِبْرَاهِيمٌ. In this place are many physical signs that can testify for the blessings of that place. فِيهِ آيَاتٌ بَيِّنَاتٌ مَقَامُ إِبْرَاهِيمٌ. One of these signs is a big piece of a stone on top of which Ibrahim, may Allah be pleased with him, used to stand on top of it. And his son Ismail would handle the blocks of a stone to him, raising the foundations of the Kaaba. And this piece of a stone is described by Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, to be as well as the black stone to be not from the earth. He, صلى الله عليه وسلم, is quoted to have said, الحجر والمقام ياقوتتان من يواقيت الجنة. The black stone and the stand of Ibrahim, may Allah be pleased with him, are two jewels from paradise. And this large piece of rock, on top of which Ibrahim, may Allah be pleased with him, used to stand on, have got the imprints of the two feet of Ibrahim, may Allah be pleased with him. And this rock is known not to melt in something less than 1,000 degrees centigrade. Who made it that soft for the two feet of Ibrahim other than Allah, or glory be to him? So this piece of rock is one of the material evidences for the holiness of Mecca al-Mukarrama, of the Haram of Mecca. فيه آيات بيات مقام إبراهيم ومن دخله كان آمنا. Whoever would enter to that place should be very secured. ولله على الناس حج البيت من استطاع إليه سبيلا ومن كفر فإن الله غني عن العالمين. It is an Islamic obligation on every Muslim, man or woman. It's an obligation to Allah to go to Mecca for pilgrimage, even for once in one's lifetime. If you can afford it, if this man or woman, Muslim man or woman, can afford it. ولله على الناس حج البيت من استطاع إليه سبيلا. Whoever can afford it. ومن كفر فإن الله غني عن العالمين. Whoever can afford this journey from amidst the Muslims, men or women, and do not do it as if he has disbelieved in Islam, disbelieved in the Quran, and disbelieved in Allah, all glory be to him. So there are many physical signs in the Kaaba, in Mecca al-Mukarrama, that can easily testify to every sane person the holiness of that place. We have seen the black stone and the stone on stand of Ibrahim, may Allah be pleased with him. We see the well of Zamzam, and we can see the water has gushed out from that well and kept on gushing out for about 4,000 years. And this water came from highly massive, impervious and impermeable igneous and metamorphic rocks that do not have any porosity. And for water to be stored in rocks, these rocks have to be highly porous and highly permeable. For a well to keep on flowing for more than or for around 4,000 years from such massive rocks is a miracle by itself. We also have many other physical signs. One of those is that the four corners of the Kaaba are in the four principal directions, the true east, the true west, the true north, and the true south. And if we understand that this Kaaba was built at a time when there was no physical means to measure the proper directions, is a physical sign for the holiness of the place. It has also been recently proved that the Kaaba is at the exact center of the continental masses. The longitude of the Kaaba of Mecca al-Mukarrama is the only longitude that points to the exact north. So it has got the magnetic north and the geographic north coinciding with each other. And this is a unique case that cannot be applied to any other spot on the surface of our planet. The continuity of that circle from the longitude of Al-Kaaba, the continuity lies mainly into the ocean. And that's why this is one of the many physical signs that can testify to the holiness of Mecca and the holiness of the Kaaba, the very first place that was established on the surface of our planet as a place of worship for human beings. Because of this, we can see clearly that directing the attention of the people at large, Muslims and non-Muslims alike, to the many physical signs that can testify to the holiness of Mecca al-Mukarrama, this holy place, is a way of inviting people towards Islam. I have found on the internet an American scholar who is non-Muslim, inviting all scientists to use the longitude of Mecca as the prime longitude, being the only longitude that directs towards the exact north, the only longitude on the surface of our planet that has got the magnetic north and the geographic north coinciding in one line. And that's why he said that we have to use the longitude of Mecca as the prime longitude. Everything lying to the east of it should be east. Anything lying west of it should be west. And he said that the Greenwich Mean Line has been imposed by the Britishers by force at a time when Britain was the superpower on the surface of our planet. They imposed the Greenwich Mean Line as the prime meridian with no scientific justification. And the Greenwich Mean Line is inclined towards the west for about 7.5 degrees. And drawing the longitudes parallel to the Greenwich Mean Line has seriously distorted the maps of the Earth. So really inviting geophysical conferences to use the longitude of Mecca as the prime longitude is a way of rectifying and correcting the maps of the world, and at the same time will be a physical evidence that can justify the holiness of Mecca and the acts of worship which are carried during a pilgrimage, during Al-Hajj, and would be used as a means of inviting the non-Muslims to respect and honor and know the importance of Mecca al-Mukarrama and the great unique features Allah has given to this holy place as a physical testimony to its holiness. So these few verses about Mecca in the glorious Quran are again among the many scientific notions that can testify to the correctness of the Holy Quran, testify to the scientific precision of the glorious Quran, can testify to the fact that this book cannot be the word of man, it's the divine word in its divine purity, and can also testify to the correct prophethood of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, being the seal of that long chain of messengers sent by our Creator for the guidance of man. And until another episode, I leave you in peace and the blessings of Allah and greeting you in our Islamic way. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May Allah's peace, blessings, and mercy be with you all.